Sometime during the invasion of Jerusalem by Philistines and Arabs during the reign of Jehoram, that is, the reign is about 850 to 840, roughly, during that time, the Edomites looked like they were going to come out and defend the people of Israel, but they switched sides. And they cut off the Israelites' escape from their captors or would-be captors. And as a result, many of us believe that that's the announcement that God has turned his attention toward the Edomites and is going to destroy them in the text. Now, bottom line is that you could make this later. You could say that this was at the time of the Babylonian conquest all the way at the end of 586 here. And that wouldn't change things terribly, but we think it's actually an earlier one. Here's the bottom line. None of that matters to you. What matters to you is what the text gives us are some very careful analyses of reasons why nations fail. And it's not just this nation, but many nations. So let's take a look at it and see if we can break down for us some of the reasons why nations fall apart. All right? Obadiah, chapter 1, verse 1. This is the vision of Obadiah. This is the commonly used term for God revealing himself. And it says, "Thus says the Lord God concerning Edom." Circle Edom. Edom is red. Edom is the red mountains, the mountains of the southeast part below the Dead Sea. And this is a kingdom that existed in a very austere, desert-like place. But it had become a very powerful kingdom. You have to really want to get to places to get to them. And it's a very dry area with some deep clefts in it. And so God is speaking out to this particular group of people. There's an expression that's used in the beginning. It's called a metonymic expression. It's, "We have heard a report," is actually, "We've heard a hearing from the Lord." God is speaking. So somewhere make a note next to verse 1. God is speaking. "And an envoy has been sent among the nations saying this." These are the words of God concerning this. "Arise, let us go against her for battle." So there's a declaration of war, and it comes from somebody who's overhearing it as coming from the Lord himself. "Arise, let us go against her for battle. Behold, I will make you small among the nations. You are greatly despised." Actually, I probably would translate that more like, "I will reduce you among the nations. I've turned from you and you are despised. You are turned away from." God has a way of saying, "I look tenderly on you," or "I turn away from you." And this is the latter. Why? Well, Edom made some mistakes. And they're mistakes that not just their nation makes. You might see a nation very near you that makes mistakes just like this one. The first mistake that I find when I'm looking through the book is that they took pride in their defenses in verses 3 and 4. Pride in their defenses. They took national pride in their defensive strength. Look what it says. "The arrogance of your heart has deceived you, you who live in the clefts of the rock, in the loftiness of your dwelling place, who say in your heart, 'Who will bring me down to earth?'" When a nation believes that it is in a position that is unassailable by other nations and it becomes arrogant, God can step in and squash it like a bug on a windshield. And the truth here is that the Edomites, because they were in this very austere place, felt very strong because of their defenses. That was the first thing. I would dare say that I've grown up in a country that has come to see itself as very well defended. And because we think we have such a daunting military, it's easy for us to walk around arrogant in the earth as though we can't be laid low by a couple of airplanes into buildings or maybe some kind of kamikaze killing of our internet. And the truth of the matter is we are very, very vulnerable. When you put too much pride in your defenses and you feel arrogant, you are set up for a fall. Let me give you the second one. They also put a lot of trust in their allies. In verse 5, 6, and 7, they put trust in their allies. "If thieves came to you, if robbers by night, oh, how you will be ruined. Would they not steal only until they had enough? If grape gatherers came to you, would they not leave some gleanings? Oh, how Esau has been! Esau will be ransacked and his hidden treasures searched out. All the men allied with you will send you forth to the border, and the men at peace with you will deceive you and overpower you. They who eat your bread will set an ambush for you. There is no understanding in him. I want you to look at the very end. At the end, it says in parentheses, there is no understanding in him. I think the NIV does a better job here. It says, you will not detect it. You won't even detect that those people who are your current allies are setting you up. I want you to know that one of the things nations do that bring them down is put too much trust in other peoples that are not their people, that are allied with them. It's easy for us to get into a situation of allies and think that they're all looking out for our best interest. They're not. They're looking out for their best interest. Every nation needs to have its leaders defend itself. And when we get into leagues with others, we need to be careful about those leagues, because those allied leagues can also lead us into a situation of destruction. People don't always tell you the truth, and you don't always know why they're helping you. And that's the situation with nations as well. Let me suggest that there's something else. In verses 8 and 9, they also put utter confidence in their nation's advisors. Here's the problem. They listen to experts. And in verse 8, it says, will I not on that day, declares the Lord, destroy wise men? Circle wise men from Edom. This is the experts. And understanding from the mountain of Esau, then your mighty men, circle that one, will be dismayed, O Timon, so that everyone may be cut off from the mountain of Esau by slaughter. He says, listen, one of the things I need you to know is if you put your confidence in all the experts and all their knowledge and in all their might, you're going to find yourself in an absolute reduced and destroyed position because your experts don't know me and I'm the one who can pull the plug on your country. Now, I put a box around verse 10 and I wrote next to that 2 Thessalonians 1:6. 2 Thessalonians 1:6. And if you're not caught up on your 2 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians in chapter 1 basically is this: mess with whatever you want, but when you mess with my kids, I'm coming after you, says the Lord. 2 Thessalonians 1:6 says it's right for God to recompense those who do evil against you. I take care of my kids. That's what 2 Thessalonians 1 is about. Well, look at this. In verse 10, it says that there's another reason. Sometimes nations fall because of national pride in their defenses. Sometimes it's because they depend on their allies. Sometimes it's because they depend on their experts and their knowledge and their mighty men. But there's a fourth reason: poor treatment of God's people. And if you look at verses 10 to 14, they poorly treated God's people, and as a result, God was going to deal with them. Here's what he says. Because of violence to your brother Jacob, you will be covered with shame and you will be cut off forever. I want you to circle that word shame. We're going to come back and look at this, particularly in some of the other books. The word shame is a national shaming. You will be cut off and you will have shame before other nations. You'll be reduced. It says, on the day that you stood aloof, on the day that strangers carried off his wealth. Here's the thing. In verse 11, you didn't help the Jewish people when they were being taken advantage of. And when somebody was coming to get them, you did not stand with them. You stood aloof, it says. What does that mean? You sat and watched people abuse my people and you did nothing. It says in verse 11, and foreigners entered his gate and cast lots for Jerusalem. You allowed the plundering of my people. When you allowed the plundering of my people, you turned my heart against you. Do not gloat over your brother's day, the day of his misfortune. Do not rejoice over the sons of Judah in the day of their destruction. Yes, do not boast in the day of their distress. Here's the thing. You not only allowed their plundering, you become verbally abusive against the people of God. You can't imagine that there were actually people on earth that would do things like go on the internet and blatantly be verbally abusive of people who follow God. Of course you can. It's all over. Everywhere you go, you can hardly see a website that doesn't have in its comment sections all kinds of blasphemous, angry, negative statements against the people of God. And God says, listen, when you treat my people that way, you watch my people suffer, or you rejoice in their failure, or you take advantage of my children, I will turn my back on you as a nation. He says, do not enter the gate of my people in the day of their disaster. Yes, do not gloat over their calamity in the day of their disaster. Do not loot their wealth in the day of their disaster. Do not stand at the fork of the road to cut down the refugees, and do not imprison their survivors in the day of their distress. Apparently, what they had done was they promised to come out to the Jewish people and be a friend to them when the Philistines came in and attacked them. And they not only turned on them, but they wouldn't allow the Jews to retreat. And so he says, You jumped in looting as we were in the middle of a war. The guys who were by my back, who were supposed to be my allies, turned on me, and now I'm being defeated in the front, and now I'm being defeated in the back. And this is what brought about such a great, terrible turnabout. Here's the thing I want you to remember. The key to the whole thing comes down to a phrase that comes in for the first time in prophetic hearing in verse 15. Put a box around the words, Day of the Lord. You're going to learn a lot about that phrase, Day of the Lord. And the Day of the Lord is a period of time that God is administering a specific punishment. That's all you need to know at this point. We're going to get more specific with that as we move through other passages. But here's what you know in verse 15. God's response is 15 to 21. Break the book into two parts. I didn't do this in the beginning, but I should do it now. The part, there are two boxes for this short book. 1 to 14, 15 to, what is it, 21? Their sin, God's response. And let's take a look at God's responses. First, you see in verses 15 and 16 that God is going to judge them with their own wicked standard and sap their strength slowly. Listen to me carefully. When they had smacked down God's people, what did God do? He didn't crush them with one blow. He did it slowly. Slowly they found themselves working harder and it wasn't working. Here's what you'll see. For the day of the Lord draws near on all the nations. Do you all see it? Verse 15 says that the day of the Lord is a period of time in which God is judging, and it's coming to all the world near you. As you have done, it will be done to you. Do you see the measure for measure principle? Do to somebody else what you want them to do for you. You will be judged according to the way you judge others, measure for measure. As you have done, it will be done to you. Don't expect to run around being cruel, angry, and sadistic, and everybody will turn around and treat you nice. The way you treated them is the way they're going to treat you. Your dealings will return on your own head. That's a great way to say that. Exactly as you have done, it will return back on your own head. Because just as you drank on my holy mountain, all the nations will drink continually. They will drink and swallow and become as if they had never existed. He said, you actually had the nerve to go into my holy place and to drink and celebrate victory over my people. I just want you to know something. I'm going to drink you into the ground. I'm going to literally, see, the thing is, when you pour out something on the ground, it doesn't disappear right away. It slowly goes down. And God's response to a godless generation is, I'm going to slowly sap your strength. He says, not only am I going to judge them by their own wicked standard, but the second thing he says is, I'm going to give their fortune back to my people. Look at verse 17. But on Mount Zion, there will be those who escape. There'll be a remnant. I'm going to judge the earth, but I'm going to hold back a remnant. So I want you to notice that in 15, the day of the Lord, judgment will be on the earth. And I want you to notice when you get down to 17, that specifically Zion, who was the people of Zion? Jewish people. We're going to use that as code language for our Jewish people. We'll have a remnant. That means, what's a remnant? So if we had this big piece of carpet and we had a little piece of the end, that would be considered a remnant. Part we didn't use or a part of the whole, but it's only part of it. It's a small part that represents the whole. So here it says, I'm going to, on Mount Zion, there will be those who escape. It will be holy. And their house of Jacob will possess their possessions. What does that mean? House of Jacob will possess their possessions. Who's the house of Jacob? God's people, Jewish people. And what are their possessions? The land God promised them. So he says, on Mount Zion, there'll be those who escape. It'll be holy. And the house of Jacob will possess their possessions. I'm going to deliver my people. I'm going to give my fortune back to my people. I know they've just been through a war in which they lost. I know that you helped them lose. I'm going to give them back what I have taken from them. So in the day of the Lord, there is the word that there's going to be on the earth judgment, but that God is going to do something with a remnant of the Jews to give them their stuff. This is really high level speech here, right? Now watch what he says. He says, then the house of Jacob will be a fire and the house of Joseph a flame, but the house of Esau will be as stubble. He says, your house coming from Esau and Edom is going to be nothing. It's going to be burned up and used out. But the house of Joseph, that's the house of the northern kingdom, and the house of Jacob, that'll be the house of the patriarchs, the Jewish people, that's going to burn. They're going to come like a flame. Now here's what's going to happen to you. You're going to be cut off completely, he says. They will set them on fire, consume them, so that there'll be no survivor of the house of Esau, for the Lord has spoken. All right, let's step back. There's going to be a time of judgment. God's going to preserve the Jewish people, give them back their stuff. He's going to destroy the Edomites. And it's not because of the Jewish people, it's because God spoke it. So God's word is what determines the end. It's not how people felt about it or whether or not Jews wanted it to happen or they liked or didn't like Jews. That's how God's going to bring it about because of his word. Keep going. There's another thing. He says, I'm going to judge them by their own standard. I'm going to give my fortune back to my people. Verse 18, I'm going to cut you off completely. Then look at verses 19 and 20. I'm going to divide the spoils of the nation to the allies and friends. Then those of the Negev will possess the mountain of Esau. And those of the Shephelah, the Philistine plain. Now those words don't mean anything to you, so let me take them apart. The Negev is the southern desert that goes across here where Beersheba is in the south of the country. This is the Negev. This, by the way, has been Israel since 1949. It's not part of the disputed. It's not the West Bank. This is Israel. And it says, those of this place will own the Edomite mountains over here. And it says then, those of the Shephelah. The Shephelah is where my finger is. It's a mountain range that is between what is today called the Gaza Strip and Judea, or the southern part of Israel. And those who possess that, those are today Israelis, will possess the area of the coast. That is the area of the Gaza Strip. If this were today, I would say what God was saying was this. Israel's going to get the southern portion of Jordan and Israel's going to get the Gaza Strip. That's what it looks like. Okay, that's if it's today. The thing is, this can be 100 years from now and things could be different. So I'm just going to set it and say, there's coming a day in which God is going to raise up the Jewish people again and give them back the land of their inheritance. Now, what's interesting is, look, they will also possess the territory of Ephraim and the territory of Samaria. That's the northern part of what today is called the West Bank. In other words, if I were writing this today, I would say what he's saying is, oh, I'm sorry, you mean there's a group out down here that has the West Bank? Israel's going to get that. Oh, there's a group of Arabs who have the Edomite mountains. Israel's going to get that. Oh, the West Bank right here, cut out of the heartland of Israel. There's a group of Arabs that are living there. Oh, Israel's going to take control of that. It looks like the very areas that are under dispute right now on this map are the areas mentioned here. Now, you can take that any way you want. And I'm not trying to be political, I'm just trying to make the point that isn't that interesting? The very places that are the dispute are all named here. And what's interesting is they're all named. Keep going. It says, and the exiles of Jerusalem who were in Sepharad. Sepharad is, it's a way, usually it refers to, it comes originally from Asia Minor and Western Turkey, but it meant the West, from the places of the West. And it can be, some people think it started as the word Sparta from the Spartans, but it now refers to people from Spain and Sephardic Jews. It comes from people from outside the country after years of exile. It says, and the exiles of Jerusalem who are in Sepharad will possess the cities of the Negev, that's the southern deserts. The deliverers will ascend Mount Zion to judge the mountain of Esau, and the kingdom will be the Lord's. Finally, he says, God will restore his people, and God will be there to make sure that the kingdom belongs to him. All right, what did we learn? We learned that nations fail because of national pride. We learned that they fail because they put trust in allies. We learned that they fail because they put trust in advisors. We learned that they fail because they attack God's people, and that's the key thing that breaks them down. And by the way, God has two different ways of using the term, my people. Spiritually speaking, we're part of a my people. In the future, God comes back and deals with the Jewish people as a people because they are also his people in another way. And so I would say this, as our nation turns against its Judeo-Christian heritage and as it turns against the believers that are in the country, it's going to find itself slowly dying or quickly dying. And I think that there are nations in the West right now that are on death watch, that if they don't watch it, they will have lost everything. Great histories, great empires are being collapsed in our lifetime. We're watching it happen. They're losing strength, and in order to compensate, they're creating social programs of ever larger governments. But they will find themselves eventually unable to function. All I think you can do with Obadiah is step back and admit that there are reasons why nations fail. And I think it's also interesting what we learn from prophetic material. So step back and say, we've been introduced to the day of the Lord. We know it's an earth-sized judgment, and that coming out of it is the Jewish people are to emerge and have a kingdom. And the end of Obadiah is that kingdom will belong to the Lord. Now, that doesn't tell you much. It just says there's coming a day when God's going to judge the nations, re-raise his people, put them back on the land, and it mentions the actual land of Israel and its physical features, and that the kingdom will belong to him. That is, at the end, Messiah's kingdom will be a thing where Jewish people are in the land. That's what we know. That doesn't help you a whole lot, does it? It shouldn't yet. But you've got lots more prophets to do. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like you to turn in your Bibles then to the book of Joel. I have behind me the three basic breakdowns of the book, three boxes, if you will. A plague of locusts had come down on the people in chapter 1. That is a past event. It had already occurred. In chapter 2, the response to that plague of locusts was to be repentance. And in chapter 3, the eventual restoration of the people from 218 to 321 would occur, but not right away. And what I want you to see is that this book appears to have something as limited as this happened bad. It's a 9/11 moment. This happened bad to you. Repent. But the implications from 218 to 321 are, but wait a minute, this is actually a sign of something that's much bigger that will go on all the way till the end. So this is God using a temporal event, a momentary event, to speak something that's going to be about a much broader period of time. And the day of the Lord will show up in 1:5, 2:1, 2:11, 2:32, 3:14. So this period of time of judgment for the world will come back. Also, the idea of shame or bush, the idea of a humbling from God on a nation is going to come back. So these we saw in Obadiah, but we're going to see them again, and this time we're going to learn more about them. Joel is absolutely essential for you to understand God's work in the church. Because when Acts chapter 2 begins, this is that which was told to you by the prophet Joel. is what happens at Pentecost at the beginning of the church. So if you know nothing about Joel, that statement helps you not a whit, because you don't know what he's talking about. So let's go back and take a look at Joel in the face of a national disaster. I don't like suspense movies. I'm not an Alfred Hitchcock fan. And I do not understand for the life of me why, when the power goes out and the phone is dead, they always go to the basement. That is like the stupidest place in the house to go when you think you might be having someone chopping your wires outside. Like, let's go to the middle of the basement, where if I scream at the top of my bloody lungs, no one can hear me. My idea is, if it becomes suspenseful, run out the door screaming like a crazy person to the first big highway you can find. If they're going to kill you, they're going to have to kill you while you're running away from them, which is a lot easier than standing in the basement, okay? So I'm not a fan of suspense. I think you got that. But here's my thing. Something bad happened. The lights flickered, then went out. We're going to call it a locust invasion. Something that should get your attention. If you are farmers, if you make your living from a farm, then locusts are a thing for you. So I want you to go back and look at the national disaster of locust and drought and searing heat and go, okay, now I understand why God is getting our attention through these. I also want you to understand that this is happening really in the 800s BC, and that the past event was to get their attention. Let's say it this way. Sometimes disasters happen in the natural world because God wants to get an attention of someone. Does that mean every time? No. A storm can come through because it's time for a storm to come through. When hurricanes come, it's not to judge something specific that we know of. Maybe it is, but we can't know that. Go down to chapter 1, verse 1. The word of the Lord came to Yoel, the son of Petuel. Now, Yah is God. El is another title for God, Elohim. And so the Lord is God, is Yoel. Okay? And it says, I want you to circle some words for me. Okay, you ready? Circle the word hear in verse 2. Circle the word tell at the beginning of verse 3. Circle the word awake at the beginning of verse 5. Circle the word at the beginning of verse 8, wail. Circle the beginning of 11, be ashamed. At the beginning of 13, gird yourselves. At the beginning of 14, consecrate. Go to 2:1, blow. All right? What I just did was connected a series of verbs, actions. And they're going to move the story for us. So it says, hear this, O elders, and listen, all the inhabitants of the land. Who's he speaking to? Elders, and all inhabitants equals everybody, okay? He's speaking to all the people that are in the land at the time in which these terrible events had occurred. Has anything like this happened in your days or in your father's days? This ever happened before? Have you ever gone through what we just went through? And of course, what's the anticipated answer? No, this is shocking. It's huge. What was it? Well, he says, tell your sons about it. Let your sons tell their sons, and the sons, the next generation. In other words, this event was so startling, I want you to pass on, boy, when President Kennedy was killed, this is where I was. When 9/11 occurred, this is where I was. Tell them of this event, this major thing that happened. What was the event? What's the thing that captured your heart? Here it is in verse 4. What the gnawing locust has left, the swarming locust has eaten. What the swarming locust has left, the creeping locust has eaten. What the creeping locust has left, the stripping locust has eaten. In other words, we just got wave upon wave upon wave of locusts, and they have cleaned our clock, and we've got nothing. Has you ever seen waves upon waves upon waves of locusts? I mean, you've had locusts, but usually they come and then we recover. This has been one after the other after the other. The first couple of years I lived in Sebring, I had moved from a war zone, and after I got here, we had three hurricanes come threshing through our town in a short period of a couple of months. I was starting to take it personally. Here's what I want you to see. They have never seen anything. And the farm economy and the agricultural economy was collapsed, and it was collapsed by something they couldn't control that they attributed to God. And so they were said, stop, look at this. Have you ever seen anything like this? We have been smushed, and it happened because of something God did. Then it says, awake, drunkards, and weep and wail, all you wine drinkers, on account of the sweet wine that is cut off from your mouth. The sweet wine is the new wine, the tirosh. It's the new crop. So it says, you dull-minded people that don't even get it need to know something. Your ABC store is going to run out of everything. You're being cut down to nothing. And it says, it's cut off from your mouth. For a nation has invaded my land, mighty and without number, and its teeth are like the teeth of a lion, and it has the fangs of a lioness. So he uses this, and he says, the locusts to him look like an organized nation, like an army that descended on them, that stripped everything. It has made my vine a waste and my fig tree splinters. It has stripped them bare and cast them away. Their branches have become white. That means the bark is gone and the tender white flesh of the inside of the vine is all that you can see. Wail like a virgin girded with sackcloth. Okay, what's that? Virgin girded with sackcloth. This is a young woman who was intending to marry, but instead of wearing a marriage dress, is wearing a mourning dress. Look at the second half. For the bridegroom of her youth, the grain offering and the drink offering are cut off from the house of the Lord. What is the grain offering? The mincha, what is it? It's a dedicatory offering to dedicate yourself to God. What is the drink offering? It's also a dedicatory offering. You said they're all cut off from the house of the Lord, meaning there's nothing to bring. I can't dedicate myself to the Lord. There's nothing left. This is a woman who looked forward to a marriage, who's lost everything. This is an empty, dry altar that has no offerings being given to it because there's nothing left. The priests mourn, the ministers of the Lord, the field is ruined, the land mourns. That's the words, the hope is depleted. Hope is gone. The grain is ruined. The new wine dries up. Fresh oil fails. We're not going to have anything. We'll be lucky to survive. Most of us don't know what a famine like this looks like. But you have to remember that in the Bible, people did not store up for ages with all the preservatives we do, markets full of food. They harvested their food, they ate their food. And then they hoped that they could space out eating their food until the next crops came in. Because the grass withers and the flower fades, and the only thing we have is the word of the Lord concerning next year's harvest to make it on, or our kids are going to go hungry. The original use of beer was to keep people with caloric intake during the time after the bread had failed, and there was no way to keep things from going rancid. So you allowed it to ferment, and you gave it to them that way because it was the only way to keep them full. These people knew what it meant to be hungry. You and I don't know that. We get hungry, we go into the cupboard and we get something. They didn't have one. So it says, be ashamed, O farmers. Wail, O vine dressers, for the wheat and the barley, because the harvest of the field is destroyed. The vine dries up, the fig tree fails, the pomegranate, the palm also, and the apple tree. All the trees of the field dry up. Indeed, rejoicing dries up from the sons of men. Here's the thing. When your cultivated crops were all come in, even if you had bad crops, you could go out to the apple trees in the orchards and go get apples. They were missing everything because the four kinds of locusts had come through and taken everything from them in the land. So what are they called to do? I mean, really, what can they do about this? I want you to see that the first box is cry, there's devastation, there's a terrible thing, and I think this is probably poorly worded. I probably would say devastation came. It doesn't mean it's not coming, but he's. It's hard to tell when he's saying it if this is an event that's already happened, that I'm going to take it, that it's a past event. So here's what I want you to do. I want to stop here and say, recognize my habits. What do I mean by that? Well, one of the things that happens is when God causes calamities, he wants to get the attention of everybody. And that's what the first four verses of the chapter were about. But self-absorbed people and self-indulgent people don't pay attention to it until it cuts off what they have. I think one of the big problems here is in verses 5, 6, and 7, awake drunkards, is that dull-minded people, if it's not hurting them, it doesn't matter. They wait until the ABC store is dry, and then they realize now we have a problem. See, the issue is in the text, if you're self-absorbed and you're self-indulgent, you only understand it when your supply line is cut. So I have to understand something. Those with the greatest optimism will be the most bitter when things fall apart. I want you to see verses 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. What he's saying is the young woman who goes out like she's about to get married is one of the happiest people in society. She's about to marry the object of her affection. The priest that comes and receives the offerings from the people, he's one of the happiest people you're going to meet, because all day long there's celebrations and shalmim, and there's lots of opportunities to be excited. And here's what he says. Farmers who go out and they farm and they bring back the crops. What a great celebration. If you've never been on a farm when the crops come in, you've missed this. Great celebration. He says, look, the people that have every reason to believe that there's a payoff coming are those who are most bitterly turned back when it's gone. It'd be sad if you lost a friend. But if you lost the person you were going to marry tomorrow, today, it'd be even sadder. Because you're not going from happiness to unhappiness. You're going from anticipation of exhilaration and joy to crushing unhappiness. Now, in the second box, there's a thing I want you to do as you face your future. I want you to look at how to repent. Can I give you some pointers on repentance? It says in verse 13, I want to give you some principles for repentance. It says in verse 13, that those who know God begin the process of taking seriously the sin. It says, gird yourselves with sackcloth and lament, O priests. Listen, it starts with the people who know God. The first people who should repent when trouble comes are the people who know God. Not the first people who should write articles to blame all the bad people in society. The first people who should repent and take seriously whatever sin has brought on us, whatever calamity comes, are the people of God. That's why it says, priests, you first put sackcloth on. Second half of verse 13. It should grip our hearts before God long before other people even hear about it. This is not simple indignance concerning the culture. It should grip our hearts when God has to send judgment on our nation. It should grip our hearts. It says, come, spend the night in sackcloth, O ministers of God. God's people ought to be the ones who are out there at the front of 57 million unborn children being aborted in this country. By the way, in verse 14, do you notice in the beginning of verse 14, consecrate a fast? Here's the thing about a fast. It's not an instantaneous event. So I would tell you, be persistent with seeking the Lord. Part of the whole idea of fasting is being persistent in seeking the Lord. So we're supposed to feel it first. We're supposed to let it grip our hearts. We're supposed to be persistent seeking the Lord. Lord, Lord, look at what the locusts have done to our nation. We come before you, not to rail against you, but to admit our own sinfulness. Oh God, how will you save our children? How will you save our nation? Then go to the verse 14. Recognize before God how the Lord and his worship have been affected. Do you notice in verse 14, he turns his attention to the fact that there's not in the house of the Lord the things that would gather the people. Gather the elders, all the inhabitants of the land, to the house of the Lord your God. Bring everybody together. Proclaim a solemn assembly. And here's the thing. The focal point of the judgment and the focal point of the repentance should be people who know God, who want to walk with God, who are ready to fall down before God. See, nothing he says is go get all those unbelievers and get them to believe God. What he says is get all the people who know God to come together for a solemn assembly and fall down in front of him. We think that the way to save America is to go out there and convince all the people who don't believe in God and don't follow after Jesus Christ that that's the thing they have to do. The very first thing we have to do is get the church's act together. We need to get on our knees and have ourselves in a position where our hearts are being measured before the Lord. Verse 14 goes on and says that we're gather the elders. That is, bring in the help of the leaders and the religious establishment and even the civil leaders. Gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land to the house of the Lord your God. Now look at the end of verse 14. Cry out to the Lord. Here's the thing. Call on everybody who's willing to heed the call to be part of the solution. Then show them how. It's not about repairing the effects of the judgment first. It's about seeking God first. See, the first thing people want to do is fix whatever's broke in society. And the first thing they ought to do is fall before the Lord, then fix what's broke. The very first thing you do is not, don't go out there and fix the vineyards. The very first thing you do is come together and seek the Lord, then go fix the vineyards. I see this all the time when I take people to third world countries and fourth world places. Take you down to Central America, take you into the villages, and the first thing that people say is, these people are so poor, we need to do something to get them some economic help. No, we need to bring the Lord to them. Because across South America, you will find that when people embraced Jesus Christ, their economies went up as a response to the work ethic that comes from walking with God. Things got moving in the economy. It's not the other way around. You can bring them all the money you want. We've got all kinds of governmental groups that'll come in and drop money there, and it won't make them better. You deal with the heart, then you deal with the externals. Here's in verse 15, warn them of later and greater judgments they need to be prepared for. Now, here it is in verse 15, and this is the first one of ours that you're going to see. Did I do that wrong? Yeah, I did. That's supposed to be a 15. Sorry. Should be 1:15. The first one of our Joel 1:15 Day of the Lord statements. Look at what it says. Sorry about that, guys. 1:15 says, alas for the day of the Lord is near, and it will come as a destruction from the Almighty. All right, let's stop for a second. The day of the Lord, as it was in Obadiah, was a time of judgment. Is it here again a time of judgment? Check, yes. Is it something that happened when the locusts came? That was a day of the Lord, but why tell them the day of the Lord is near if it already happened? So this is a future event. And is it a judgment event? Read verse 15 and tell me if it sounds like judgment. It will come as destruction. Yes, that's sounding judgmenty, isn't it? Is it a God event? Or do men get together and pollute the planet and cause it? No. It is a from the Lord, so it's a time of judgment to the world. It's a coming time, and it's coming from the Lord. So some of this is remembered in 1:15. Let that sit there, because we're going to build on what Obadiah said as we look at it through what Joel said. Why? Same author, Holy Spirit. Now, take a look at it. It says 1:16, another point of repentance is this. Point out the reality of God's work that should be obvious. Look at verse 16. Has not food been cut off before our eyes, gladness and joy from the house of our God? Here's the thing. He goes on and says, the seeds shrivel under the clods. The storehouses are desolate. The barns are torn down. The grain is dried up. How the beasts are groaning. The herds of the cattle wander aimlessly because there's no pasture for them. Even the flocks of sheep suffer. This is what he says. He says, look, it ought to be obvious to you, but just in case it's not, let me point out to you, hello, God has judged, and God is going to again. Now, what's interesting is, in verses 19 and 20, if you've been sort of coasting along with my voice for the last few minutes, drop into 19 and 20. Focus on the real need. What's the real need? A walk with God. To you, O Lord, I cry. For the fire has devoured the pastures of the wilderness, and the flame has burned up all the trees of the field. Even the beasts of the field pant for you. The water brooks are dried up, and fire has devoured the pastures of the wilderness. Here's the thing. He's not giving God a condition report. God knows exactly what got burned up. What is he doing? He's saying, to you, O Lord, I cry, because in every direction that I would normally get help, it's gone. There's no one else and nowhere else for me to turn. Now, why is that important? Because it helps set up how the future was illustrated in the past. This event of the past caused the requirement that we would repent in 2, 12 through 17, but this past is going to look like a future event again. In other words, the day of the Lord was both a judgment yesterday and one that's coming. All the judgments are called a time of the Lord, a day of the Lord. So we're going to pick up in chapter 2, and I want you to see the future illustrated in the past. Look at it. It's like a coming time, a picture of the day of another coming, another time, another repentance. I want you to notice it says, "Blow a trumpet in Zion. Sound an alarm on my holy mountain." What's the blow a trumpet? It's a way you gather the people, but I want you to understand it's a time marker. They didn't have clocks, they had trumpets. The trumpet blew, and that's how everybody knew it was time to do whatever. You know, so it's true, Big Ben rings in London and everybody can look up and see the face of the clock, but you don't have to look up. The sound of it was enough to tell you what was going on. That's why at the hour and the half hour there are sounds. Okay, that comes from a very old tradition. Back before there was a clock, there was a trumpet. So blow a trumpet in Zion is a time marker in Zion. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. Now you see a future eventual coming. So this, we're going to add the word coming here. The day of the Lord, clearly, when we add from Obadiah also Joel, what we know is it's a coming day of judgment. Obadiah said it was for the world. This doesn't yet tell us that. But here's what it's described as. A coming day of judgment, surely it is near. A day of darkness, gloom, clouds, thick darkness, as the dawn is spread over the mountains, so there is a great and mighty people. Actually, the word is a great and mighty host. I want you to see that, because I want you to write next to it also Revelation 16, 18. We're going to come back and describe that in a minute. But there is a great and mighty host. There has never been anything like it, nor will there ever be again. What did we just add to our definition about the day of the Lord? It's not only a coming event, it's a coming singular time of judgment that is more than any other. It's the coming singular, unmatched time of judgment that's coming on the world. Do you understand how I got there? The phrase is, it's never been this bad and it will never be again. That means it's a coming future judgment, but when it comes, it will be one and unlike any other, more powerful than any other. What you're starting to see is the beginnings of a statement of tribulation, a time of trouble so big and so unique that there's no other time like it. Now, why is that important? Because we're going to be developing a theology of eschatology, last things. And we have to develop it from the text. But I want you to see, Obadiah gave us the background of the beginning in the first of our seven books. But in the second one, we're getting even more parts to put on it. Guys, look, I don't care what your belief of the future is. I care that you get it from the text and that you can defend it from the text. I don't care if you agree with me on all this or not. That doesn't matter to me. Here's what matters to me. If you believe something's going to happen, you better be able to indicate it from the Bible. If you believe that you understand how the future is going to play out, get it from the Bible and be able to stand and hold your ground. Okay? So here's what I'm saying. I'm saying that God is promising through Joel, a prophet, that there's coming a day of trouble that is unlike any other trouble ever in the world. Somebody hold your finger there, go to Revelation 16, 18 and read it really loud. Loudly, in a loud fashion.
And there were flashes of lightning and sounds and peals of thunder, and there was a great earthquake, such as there had not been since man came to be upon the earth. So great an earthquake was it, and so mighty.
Okay, there is judgment on the earth. And in Revelation, he makes the same phrase, it's never been that bad and never will be. But what you should know is the book of Revelation is formed around three rounds of judgment. And the first one in a series of seal judgments in Revelation 6, then another set of judgments that are trumpet judgments, then another set of judgments that are bowl judgments. This one comes from the third of the bowl judgments. The important thing is this. That phrase is reserved in the Bible for the worst judgment ever. Okay? Now, keep going. Verse 3, a fire consumes them and behind them a flame burns. A fire consumes them and behind them a flame burns. They can't run back. The land is like the Garden of Eden before them, but a desolate wilderness behind them. That is, it's beautiful as they look ahead, but as they're coming upon it, it's being destroyed. And as they look back with them coming, it's being destroyed right in their midst. And nothing at all escapes them. It is total, it is terrible, it is destructive. Whatever he's talking about the day of the Lord here, he's saying it's total, terrible, destructive, and that's why we say it's to the world. Obadiah said it was to the world. He says everywhere they go, it's just destroyed underneath of them. Their appearance is like the appearance of horses. And like war horses, so they run. What, when you say the appearance is like the appearance of horses, what are you referring to? They're heavy, they got big noses. What are we saying? What's the thing about horses that you would think of?
They're big, they're strong, fast.
It's swiftness. You have to remember that these guys fought on camels and mules. Horses were much faster than anything that they had. So it says, and they're like war horses, so they run. It's Solomon that brings in horses into the chariots. Up to that point, Israel really, really made it on mules. Remember, Saul and David fought from mules. With a noise of chariots, they leap on the top of mountains like the crackling of a flame of fire consuming the stubble, like a mighty people arranged for battle. Here's what I see. Whatever this destruction is, it's swift. It's loud, it's devastating, it's complete, it's organized. And by the way, there's no real opposition. I get that from verse 6. Before them, the people are in anguish, all faces turn pale. There's no real opposition. These guys are rolling through. Whatever this judgment is, it's coming in a mighty way. And as it rolls through, people are just turning pale before it. They run like mighty men. They climb the walls like soldiers, and they march each in line, nor do they deviate from their paths. They do not crowd each other. They march everyone in his field. And when they burst through their defenses, it's highly orchestrated, the whole thing. They do not break ranks. They rush on the city. They run on the wall. They climb into the houses. They enter through the windows like a thief. He says, he's seeing this incredible invasion. Is it locusts? Is it people? I don't know, but it's a description of the day of the Lord, and it's big, and it's devastating, and it's absolutely worse than it's ever been, and the worst that it will ever be on the face of the earth. What's interesting is if you were to take the time to read what Zoe was reading to us around Revelation 16, there's another description of this event. It's organized, it's devastating, and it's worldwide. And this is what, I put a box around verse 10, and I see that nature is destroyed in it. Before them the earth quakes, the heavens tremble, the sun and the moon grow dark, and the stars lose their brightness. If you have an opportunity, while holding your place there, go to Matthew. I just very, very quickly want to point out to you something. In the passage I'm looking for, in Matthew 24, is a passage that follows this same basic pattern. Matthew 24, Jesus came out from the temple, verse 1, and was going away when his disciples came up to point to the temple buildings to him. And he said to them, "Do you not see all these things? Truly I say to you, not one stone will be left upon another which will not be torn down." Jesus is talking about a future event or a past event? Future event. As he was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, "Tell us, when will these things be?" Underline the "when will these things be." That's their question. What's the timing of this future event? And when will be these things be happening? And what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? Underline end of the age. When is this over? And his answer is, "See to it that no one misleads you. Verse 5, for many will come in my name and say, I am the Messiah, and will mislead many. You will be hearing of wars and rumors of wars. For see that you are not frightened, for those things must take place. But that is not yet the end. Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. In various places there will be famines and earthquakes, but these are merely the beginning of birth pangs. Do you see again now the earthquakes that are mentioned in Joel 2:10? Go on and say verse 9 of 24:9, then they will deliver you to tribulation. Circle the word tribulation. And will kill you, and you will be hated by all nations because of my name. He's talking to a group of Jewish followers about a future that's going to happen. At that time, many will fall away and will betray one another and hate one another. Many false prophets will arise. Because lawlessness is increased, most people's love will grow cold. The word lawlessness, anomia, does not mean they don't have any rules. It means they make up their own. Because people make up their own moral rules, the natural fabric of society falls apart. Because they call everything a marriage, nothing's a marriage. Because they call everything a family, they don't know what a family is, so they don't know how to make one. But the one who endures to the end, he will be saved. The gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations. Then the end will come. And he goes on and talks about the middle of a period of the tribulation, says, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation, which was spoken of through Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place, let the reader understand, then those who are in Judea must flee to the mountains. And he goes on and he talks about what you're to do. And in case you're wondering if these are Jews, look at verse 20. Pray that it doesn't happen on a Sabbath day. If this is not, remember, he's talking to Jewish believers who are both Christian in the sense that they're followers of Christ, and happen to be Jewish. So the question is he talking about this for the future of Christians or the future of Jews? I think he gives it away. Be careful to wish that it's not on a Sabbath. That probably doesn't mean the Christians are the ones in view here. So what you're looking at is something that God is going to do in a powerful way. And if you kept on reading down to verse 29, it would say this, but immediately after the tribulation of those days, now listen to this, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, when all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of the sky with power and with great glory. Do you notice how similar that is to what you read in 2:10 of Joel? Before them the earth quakes, the heavens tremble, the sun and the moon grow dark, the stars lose their brightness. The Lord utters his voice before his army. Surely his camp is very great, for strong is the one who carries out his word. The day of the Lord is indeed great and very awesome. Who can endure it? If you read all of chapter 24 of Matthew, you will read that the major issue is what Jesus says if verse Matthew 24, 22, and I'd write it right alongside of Joel 2:11, Matthew 24, 22, unless those days had been cut short, that is by God, so no life would have been saved, but for the sake of the chosen, those days will be cut short. Do you see 2:11? It's so strong. Who can endure it? Who can make it through? Jesus said, if it weren't for the fact that I pulled the plug early, nobody would. Do you see the relationship? I'm not asking you to understand everything about what you read in Matthew 24, because we're coming back to that passage. You'll get good at that passage. But right now, do you see a correlation between coming a time of judgment, it'll be worse than anything anybody's ever seen. When Jesus talks about it, he talks about it in the frame of the Jewish people. He says they're going to hate you from every corner of the world, hate you for everything you stand on, and you are going to go through such terrible tribulation. You better pray it doesn't come on a Sabbath. And then when God is speaking to the people of Israel in Joel, he says, the day of the Lord is awesome. Who can endure it? Jesus said, if I didn't cut it short, nobody could. I want you to understand that the next segment goes back again and tries to call the people to repentance. Why? What is the day of the Lord, based on what you've read in Joel and Obadiah, what's it supposed to do? besides beating up on the earth, what is its outcome according to Obadiah? Do you remember? He says, sitting in front of a list that has it on there. Okay, which people? Okay, in this case, see, the problem with the Hebrew scriptures is they're only worried about what happens to Jews. There are no Gentiles in this because they don't even know that's going to be a thing. They don't know that you're going to be pig-eating pagans and come to Jesus. They have no idea. As far as they're concerned, they're the people of God, and you never will be. It's not till the New Testament and the shocking development of the gospel that they're able to see that. As far as they're concerned, there's one people of God, and that's the Jewish people. And whatever this is, it's going to be terrible. And however it's going to work out, it is for the Jewish people to repent. So, let me suggest to you that its purpose, it ends in kingdom and restoration. It's a time of a remnant to bring Israel to repentance. We can keep this going for a long time because we're going to find in one passage after another more and more and more about this day of the Lord. Let me say it this way. Joel says that the day of the Lord is directed toward Israel. It is a worldwide event. It is a time of trouble unlike any other trouble that it's ever been. Jesus said it's still coming in the future. It hasn't happened yet. He also talks about the day of the Lord. And in fact, he says that it's something that is supposed to get the Jewish people's hearts to melt and repent. Let's look at that repentance for a minute. 2:12. Yet even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, weeping, mourning. Rend your heart and not your garments. Don't tear your clothes, tear your hearts. For he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in loving kindness and relenting of evil. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing from him, even a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Blow a trumpet in Zion. Consecrate a fast, proclaim a solemn assembly, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children, the nursing infants. Let the bridegroom come out of his room and the bride out of her bridal chamber. Let the priests, the Lord's ministers, weep between the porch and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not make your inheritance a reproach, a byword among the nations. Why should they among the people say, where is their God? He says, get the people together and tell them, this is our opportunity nationally as the people of Israel to repent. We are in trouble. We are going to be destroyed. Everybody, nobody, no exceptions. Drop what you're doing and come and wail and weep. This tribulation will not pass us if we do not turn to the Lord. Look at the beginning of verse 18. Circle the word then. Then the Lord will be zealous for his land. It will bring Israel to repentance, comma, then it ends in kingdom and restoration. So what he's saying is, there's coming a time. It's a heavy time. It's a dark time. It's a worldwide time. It's a punishing time. But it's directed to get my people to bow their stiff neck. And when they do, that's when I will come and restore them, and not before.